Hey everybody, it's Chief Meteorologist Brad Panovich here, and today's topic is one that's near and dear to my heart. I actually couldn't fit it on the bottom there. So today's topic is going to be about the moon and the night sky in astronomy. Now, as a meteorologist, the first question I often get from people, do you study meteors? Now, no, we don't, but I do love space, and looking at the sky is definitely part of our job, and I love looking at the night sky. And last night, we had a particular event which was pretty amazing. We had the full pink supermoon. So it really let me talk, gave me an idea to talk about, you know, what the moon is, how the moon phases work, what all that nonsense was about pink and super. I'll explain that and talk about some tools you can use to look at the night sky, because we have some really cool events that you can go out in the night sky and check out. So we're going to talk a lot about that. This is my picture last night. I took a picture of the full moon last night. It was full around 10:30. It was referred to as a supermoon and a pink moon. Now, where does the word pink come from? It obviously is not the color pink. That's the funny thing about it. The pink moon actually has nothing to do with its color. It has to do with the time of year it occurs. Every full moon that happens every month has a name. It's been given by either Native Americans or local tribes who would notice things happening in nature at about the same time that full moon occurs. So those names actually stretch throughout the year. In fact, in January, it's called the wolf moon because that was the time of year that wolves would howl. In February, the snow moon, because the full moon happens when there's a lot of snow on the ground. March was the worm moon. Now, the moon doesn't look like a worm. The reason it's called the worm moon, that's the time of year that worms start to come out and robins start eating them. You know, we always look for that first robin. And here in April, the April full moon is always called the pink moon because it's the time of year that these pink flowers would start to bloom in the month of April, especially right around Easter time. May is another flower theme. It's the flower moon because most flowers will bloom fully across the area, especially northern latitudes in May. June's the strawberry moon. That's when the strawberry harvest becomes a big deal. The buck moon is the July moon. That's typically when deer start growing their antlers, and so it's called the buck moon. August is the sturgeon moon. That's the name we give to the August moon because that's when sturgeon start to go into the Great Lakes and swim upstream to do some mating. September, October, sometimes they are kind of mixed together. The harvest moon, which most of us know, that's the time that harvest would occur. September, though, is often referred to as the corn moon because that's when most of the corn crop is harvested as well. So you got kind of a double September, October, usually corn moon, harvest moon are back to back. October's the hunter's moon because that's the time of year people hunt. And November's the beaver moon. This is the time of year that beavers build their dams before the winter hits. And December, the cold moon, because that's when things start to get cold. So that's where those names come from. But last night's moon was also referred to as a supermoon. What in the world is that? So let me show you this picture. I'm going to zoom in here so you guys can see it. So last night, we called it a supermoon because it was slightly larger than our average size moon. You can see the average size moon is roughly about that size. Last night was a supermoon, and we have something called a micromoon. So why does the moon change shape slightly throughout the year? Well, it has a lot to do with the orbit around the Earth. It's not a complete circle, or I should say a perfect circle. What happens is certain times a year, apogee is when the moon is really far away from Earth on this elliptical orbit. When it's really close to the Earth, we call it perigee. Now, supermoon was just something that people invented in the last couple years to refer to this moon, which is a perigee moon. It's never really, astronomers never called it supermoons. They just called it a perigee moon. It just meant that it was closer to the Earth than normal. And today, or last night, really this morning, was the closest approach for 2020. So it was approximately 221 miles away from the Earth. You could see on average it's 225 at perigee. So last night was a really close moon. That's why it was a supermoon. Now, if I didn't tell you this, you would not have noticed the difference in the size of the moon. You only would have noticed that if you put them all side by side. So if you took a picture of equal proportions, the micromoon or the apogee moon would look like that, an average moon would look like that, and the perigee moon would look something like that. So unless you were looking at them side by side, it would just look like another full moon last night. Now, why do we have phases of the moon? This is a question I get often from kids. Well, it has a lot to do with that orbit, again, that we talked about around the Earth. It's endless dance. We only see one side of the moon all the time. We don't see the far side of the moon because the moon doesn't rotate itself. It orbits around the Earth facing us the same direction. What changes is the orientation of the Earth, the moon, and the sun. The sun is like a giant flashlight which illuminates one side of the moon. But because the moon is orbiting around the Earth, we see various shades of that sunlight hitting it. So I did a little quick video with my kids to kind of show you how this works, and you can do this at your house as well. It's really simple. Use a soccer ball, golf ball, flashlight, find a dark room, and you can see this for yourself. So take a look at this. The moon, which is going to be represented by this golf ball. Now what we're going to do is we're going to take my little smiley face man, and we're going to stick him on planet Earth. Obviously, this person is not to skip. So we are going to stick him on our soccer ball right there. And we're going to go into my daughter's room and show you how this works. So Kyler, follow me. All right. So on the ground, I'm going to turn on our sun. This is going to be our sun right here. There is you on planet Earth. This is the moon, which orbits around the Earth once every 30 days. So for instance, if we have a new moon, you can see the sun's illuminating the opposite side of the moon. And if I'm sitting right here, I see dark. But as the moon orbits around our planet, you see a quarter moon. So this is a half moon. And as the moon goes around the Earth and goes to the opposite side, it becomes a full moon. Notice you see the full disk, and then it keeps rotating around. You see a half a moon, and it does this every 30 days. So this is why you see the different phases of the moon. It's all because of the rotation of the moon around Earth. And because of your orientation, this is what you see. So kind of a cool little thing you can do at home to kind of show how the moon changes phases. Now, another question I get often is sometimes people see the moon during the day and go, why am I seeing it during the day? Well, that actually happens all the time. As long as the moon is in the sky and the sun is in the other part of the sky, you're going to see it. Remember, the moon is showing you reflected sunlight. It is the, well, I always tell people, at night, it's our brightest object in the sky, but in the sky in general, the sun is our brightest. The moon is the second brightest, and the third brightest object in our sky that we see at night is Venus. So if you see a really bright star, that is going to be Venus. So let me show you a couple other things you can see in the night sky, because I like to take pictures of the moon in various phases. I'm going to show you a couple different pictures. This is a quarter moon that I have a picture of that I took of. Here's one that's kind of during the day. You can see it's a three-quarter moon that I took during the day. Here's a couple other full moon shots throughout the year I take one. This one's not completely full. You can see the upper part there is a little off. Here's another shot, and I've taken various shots of the moon. Here's another one during the day, which are really cool. You take these during the day, they look pretty spectacular and are fun to look at. But there's other things in the night sky you can see. One of the things I love to take pictures of is the International Space Station flying over. So what I do is long exposures. This is actually a cell phone tower, and that is a long exposure of the space station flying over. Here's a couple different views of it. There's one I took not too long ago. That's not a picture of it. Let me grab another one. These are mostly from my backyard. So I do long exposures to take pictures of it. But there's other cool things. If you know where to look in the sky and you have just binoculars or a pretty good camera, you can take pictures of pretty cool stuff as well. Let me show you some other cool things I've taken pictures of. The Orion Nebula, which is right there, and Comet Lovejoy, which might be hard to see. I'm going to try to zoom in a little bit, and we'll try to move the map up. But if you look very carefully right there, I actually caught a picture of Comet Lovejoy. Now, you can't see that with the naked eye unless you take a picture and really focus in on it. But just simple binoculars will help. There's the Orion Nebula. It doesn't look like much without a telescope, but even with a camera, you can see quite a bit. Let me show you a couple other cool pictures I've taken of constellations in the sky. That's Venus, actually. Let me show you another one of Comet Lovejoy that I was able to get a couple years ago. Whoops. Let me take a zoom in on that. See that little fuzziness? That's fuzziness because there's ice coming off of it. One of my other favorite pictures to take is when the moon has other planets or stars around it. Here's a picture of, I believe this was Venus and maybe Jupiter. I have to think back on this one, but this was a pretty cool shot where we had a crescent moon, and you can actually see what we call moonshine, which is the Earth reflecting off the moon, so you still see the full disk, and then you've got a couple planets there. Here's another picture of that, which I think is pretty cool. One shot that I get often and people are amazed by, and I only do this with my camera, is pictures of Jupiter and its moons. So this is really amazing. People are always blown away by this picture. So what you're looking at is a little fuzzy because actually I'm looking just through a camera. I've taken a 300 millimeter lens. I've zoomed in on Jupiter and you can actually see four of the moons which are going around Jupiter. Now, Jupiter has a ton of moons, but the largest ones are bigger than some planets. So they do show up with a telescope or a camera or even binoculars. You don't even need a fancy one. So that's Jupiter and its moons. So what are some cool things that we're going to see over the next, I'd say, couple days? There's actually an event tomorrow morning that if you want to get up early and check out, that you'll be able to see. And I'm going to bring up a piece of software that you can download for free. It's called Stellarium. I'll actually show you the website here in a minute, but it's a free software application you can run on your computer. And the cool thing about it is you set it for Charlotte, your location. So this is a view of our sky right now. You can see the south, southwest, west. But what I can do is go into tonight, we'll go forward in time. Let's watch the western sky because we'll see the sunset here. I'll speed it up a little bit. So we're going through time this afternoon and you'll see the sun coming up here. Ooh, we'll slow it down. So there's the sun. I sped it up. And we'll see the sun set in the western sky. And it'll get dark out. And the cool thing about once it gets dark, the software lets you start looking for things in the sky. The first thing you notice in the western sky tonight, really bright object, that's Venus. And we can look at the whole sky. So we still got twilight. Let's go a little bit later after dark so it gets a little darker out. And now we start to see constellations show up and different planets. There's Sirius. We can click on them and see what that is. That's Cygnus. That's actually a satellite. So some of the satellites show up. That's a pretty bright one. You can see it moving right there. So we look at the night sky, but something's going to come up tomorrow morning that I'm going to show you. I'm going to go fast forward again here, and we're going to stop this as the moon rises in the eastern sky. You can see it rising right there. We're going to go through time and I'm going to let this go. And tomorrow morning, we're going to have a pretty cool setup because tomorrow morning, we are going to see Saturn, Mars, and Jupiter line up in the sky, pre-dawn sky. So let this, I'm going to go a little quicker so we can see it. There we go. So we're looking southeast tomorrow morning and the time here is 4:45 in the morning. So if you don't want to get up at 4:45, let's go closer to 5 or 6 when most people will get up. I'm going to stop this around 5:30 a.m. And you guys can see in the southeastern sky, we're going to have a spectacular show of Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter all lined up in the southeast sky. So this will be really cool to see tomorrow. And there it is right before dawn. So the southeast sky, it should look rather spectacular. This is actually coming up tomorrow morning, Thursday, April 9th. And the cool thing about this software, again, Stellarium is the software, is you can just pull this up on your computer. And I'm actually going to pull it up right now so you guys can download this. And you can set it for Charlotte or whatever location you have. I'm actually going to bring it over on screen here. You can see it's available for Mac and Windows. You download this software and it basically gives you the ability to look at objects in the sky. And one of the cool things, if you want to look at constellations, you can set them up and turn them on. So here, there we go. See it. And you can actually add the artwork. My son loves this because he likes to see the pictures of what the constellations are supposed to look like. And so you can actually see like Scorpio and some of these other awesome, Greek mythical characters that made up some of our constellations. So if you've ever wondered what's in the sky, you can pull this up and take a look, and you can look into the future. So what is it going to look like tomorrow morning? I just showed you with the southeast sky. You can see what's going to show up in our southeast sky by going forward because down at the bottom here, you can go into the future. Now, if you don't want to download this for your computer, there are some great tools on your phone. One of my favorites is SkyView. SkyView is pretty amazing because it allows you to use your camera as a VR tool and you can point it at an object in the sky and it'll tell you what it is. So if you don't know what you're looking at in the sky, you can pull up your phone and aim it right there. And on your phone, through your camera lens, it'll tell you what you're looking at. Another great tool, if you wanted to follow me, I always post when the space station is going to be visible, at least at Great Pass, is something called the ISS Spotter. It's a really great tool for spotting things in the sky. And so I'm gonna bring me up full screen here. So I'll show you guys real quickly. Those are the tools I use on my phone. You can see the one I have down there that I love, which is called SkyView. That one is amazing, and ISS Spotter. So Planets and Sundial are a couple other apps I highly recommend. So if you get a chance, certainly check out Stellarium, because to me, it's one of my most favorite pieces of software, because it just gives you a great view of what's coming up in the night sky, and it really gives you a real-time look of where things are. So if you like to take pictures, it's always a great tool to use. And remember, if you see some of these things online about cool astronomical events, I will caution you, always check with me or do a little research. Sometimes these are blown up beyond proportion, because a lot of these events aren't always visible with the naked eye, and they're not always visible in the city where there's a lot of light. So especially some of the weaker meteor showers, which always aren't the best. So again, thanks for tuning in today. This was always one of my passions as a side thing to weather, is astronomy and space. Hope you enjoyed today.